Okay, we went through the four steps of executing an A/B test: preparation, implementation, running an experiment, and evaluating the experiment. But before we finish this module, we have to discuss two more things that you should take care of after finishing your A/B test. These are documentation and following up on your results. Let's talk about documentation first. Okay, so what I suggest here is that whether your A/B test is a winning or a losing one, you should always write a short, one-page summary about it. This one-pager can contain your initial hypothesis and research results. You can add the hard facts to it, like the conversion change and statistical significance level that you have seen at the evaluation step, and also a few additional thoughts about your conclusions and takeaways from the experiment. The long-term goal of this documentation process is to build an internal company knowledge base. A knowledge base that basically collects all the experiments you and your colleagues ran at your company. It will be useful for three things. First of all, it's always useful if you can look back at your previous experiments and recall what have you done and why, what you have learned, what you shouldn't A/B test again, and so on. The second reason is that it will be great for your colleagues as well. Even those people who didn't participate in the project can get a quick summary of the most important takeaways, and they can learn from what you have done. Believe me, your colleagues will love you for that. And third, this knowledge base will play an important role in building a strong A/B testing culture within your company. If you want to learn more about this topic, I wrote an article about how to evangelize A/B testing and grow an experiment-driven culture at your online business. I link the article below this video. The point is, after evaluating it, always write a one-page summary about your A/B test. And then collect all these one-pagers into a place where the whole company can access it. It doesn't have to be fancy. For instance, I usually use a simple Google spreadsheet. So this is how I like to structure my knowledge base. I add these columns. When did the test start? When did it end? The short summary of my initial hypothesis. Whether my hypothesis was proved or disproved. A one-sentence summary of the takeaways. A link to the more detailed one-pager of the test. And of course, I add the person who you can go to for more information if needed. The idea behind this structure is that anyone who goes through this document can quickly review the most important information. And if something grabs her attention, she can go deeper. I like to keep this knowledge base and my A/B testing idea backlog in one spreadsheet on different tabs, so they are all in the same place. Of course, online businesses with a more mature A/B testing program and with a great experiment-driven culture can build their own knowledge base platform too. The spreadsheet solution that I showed you here is really just the simplest one that everyone can sort out. In the action lecture of this module, we will talk a bit more about this topic. But here, let's talk about another important thing, follow-ups. Here's the thing. When you run an A/B test, you check only its immediate impact. But it's also important to follow up in a few months so you can see the long-term effects too. Here's an example. Let's say that you have a product with a subscription plan and you want to get more registrations. You run the test, you evaluate it, and it turns out that version B performs 30% better than version A. Nice job. You release it to your whole audience. The number of registrations indeed goes up. But just in case, 3 months later, you check out the cancellation rate of the users who have seen version B in your A/B test, and you compare it to the cancellation rate of the version A users. Let's say that you see that in version B, almost every user cancels their subscription, while in version A, everybody sticks with you. Well, then version B was great in the short term, but in the long term, it was a disaster. Well, of course, this was a very, very extreme example, and something like this never happens in real life, but you get the point. You should always follow up with your experiments. Unfortunately, the technical part of this can be tricky. If you have your own in-house A/B testing software, then of course you can tag your A/B test participants and easily follow up with their long-term metrics later. But if you use Google Optimize or Optimizely, this tagging solution is really hard. Well, frankly, it's mostly impossible to do. This is one of the limitations of these third-party tools, so this is what we have to work with. That's not a huge problem, though. Even if you use Google Optimize or Optimizely, you should at least think of the long-term impact of your new version. And even if you can't follow up that methodically and accurately like I described with the tagging solution, you can still check the aggregated numbers and monitor whether your long-term metrics go up or down after releasing a new version of your A/B test for your whole audience. Documentation and following up with your experiments are small things. Still, in the long term, they can add a lot of value to your A/B testing program. So don't forget about them. And with that, we are done with the execution module. We have discussed how to prepare an experiment and create a well-funded, promising A/B test idea, how to implement it properly, how and for how long to run it, and eventually, how to evaluate it without lying to yourself. And great news, we are done with all the big topics in the course, and now you know everything that you have to know to A/B test like a data scientist. In the remaining modules, I will add a few more thoughts that didn't naturally fit into the main curriculum. These will be smaller, but sometimes important questions. And then I will summarize everything and highlight the most important takeaways of the course.